So before going to, I will try to move a little bit more fast now, but in order to make sure that we are all on the same page and understand what the foundation of this coherent averaging that I have alluded to is, let me revisit what was a very useful starting point. This was many years ago, but it's still a good model to have in mind. This is an example where we consider a single qubit, could be your favorite qubit that you have, in contact with a quantum mechanical bath that consists of non-interacting harmonic oscillators. Well, what can we do? We love spin 1/2, we love harmonic oscillators, let's put them together, and hopefully let's do it in such a way that the interaction part is of a simple form in such a way that this is the total Hamiltonian that we get. It's three pieces, system, bath, and interaction. But the simplifying feature of this Hamiltonian, if you look about that, is like there is a preferred basis. There is a symmetry in this Hamiltonian, namely the fact that the system contribution and the interaction terms, they commute with one another, which means physically that even though the system, the qubit, is in interaction with this environment, there is no genuine exchange of energy that can happen because the Z, the computational basis, if you like, is preserved. And nevertheless, if we prepare an initial state, which is a superposition of the up and down, because of the coupling to the environment, we are going to have decoherence, loss of coherence, that is introduced in the evolution of the system. Now, I would like to say this is a nice model mathematically because we can actually, under very mild assumptions, compute exactly the dynamics for the qubits, but it's not totally unphysical at all. If some of you is familiar with exciton qubits in self-assembled quantum dots, for instance, this is called the diagonal spin boson model, and it's a pretty good representation of decoherence introduced by phonon modes in this kind of charged exciton qubits. Anyway, back to us, the coherence dynamics, we are talking about a qubit, so in this case, because the Hamiltonian of the system commutes with interaction, nothing is going to happen, nothing interesting is going to happen to the population, so the diagonal entries of the density matrix of the qubit, all the action, all the interesting effects is in the off-diagonal term, which quantifies the coherence of the qubit. Right? Is that clear? I don't have to worry about the population. Whatever the value was at initial time, same, it will be a constant of motion. Okay, so I only have to compute essentially the off-diagonal density matrix, which we can get. The procedure here would be to compute the unitary evolution for the qubit in the presence of the bath, and then to trace over the degrees of freedom of the bath. This procedure can be carried out for this model exactly under only two assumptions, namely that initially the bath is in thermal equilibrium, which is a fairly natural assumption, physically speaking, and secondly, that's an important one, that initially at time zero, say, the spin and the bath are uncorrelated. That's an assumption that we always do when it comes to describing open systems. So, anyway, back to this, what we can find out in that case is that the exact time evolution of the coherence of our qubit is what it was initially. Of course, we don't have at the beginning, we are never going to get coherence back. Then there is a free oscillation with a Larmor frequency here. I have a 2 because I didn't divide by 2 here. I think this is unintentional. I think Chris Monroe was doing the same, but no correlation here. And then there is an exponentially, well, I said this is an exponential, but the function that is here is not a pure exponential. It's something that can be computed as this form. This is called the decoherence function. And you can view it as a sum. If you take a continuum, if you imagine now, rather than having a countable number of oscillators, you take a continuum limit. Think about phonons, think about electromagnetic modes. You have a continuum of frequencies which are distributed in a certain way over frequency range, the certain way being determined by what we call the spectral density of the environment. That one, and this beta is inverse temperature for the environment. We can exactly compute this function. It's a real function, as you see, and it goes here into causing the decay of the coherence element down to zero if we don't take precautions. Now, that's exactly what we want to prevent. We would like, so, to come in with the same philosophy of the spin echo, and trying to see whether we can intervene actively with some control action in such a way that the qubit is either slowed down or doesn't decay at all over time. So the intuition that we can follow here is to have a look at the interaction part here. This is through the sigma z operator. And thinking back to the spin echo, we were using pi pulses to invert the state of the spin. So we can also notice that depending on whether, intuitively speaking, the value of sigma z is up or down, then we pick up two different contributions, contribution with an opposite sign to this interaction Hamiltonian. So if we could come up with a protocol that keeps flipping the states up and down, and so forth over time, and we would consider the evolution of the qubit over a sufficiently long time scale so that we give an opportunity for some average over time to occur, the intuition would or could tell us that maybe we end up with an effective Hamiltonian where the net coupling between the system and the bath, the qubit and the oscillator, is averaged out to zero. So in practice, in order to enact the protocol that I was talking about, all we have to do is to, in principle, this is theory, like consider pi pulses that are able to flip the state of the qubit. And let's imagine that we have the possibility to apply them in zero time, so they are instantaneous. This is what NMRs, they often call them delta pulses. It's an approximation, but it's a very useful one. And let's imagine that we can apply them, in principle, very fast. You see this word here, this bang-bang word. This is a term that comes from the engineering control literature. A bang-bang controller is a controller that actually switches between between the maximum and the minimum values, like thermostats for temperature control, typically, or the most naive one, they operate in a bang-bang fashion. They are very singular. They are nothing at all, but they are quite useful to get an intuition into what's going on. So suppose the intuition, the physical intuition, is all in this equation here. Suppose that we do the following, and have spin echo in mind. We let the system evolve under its own Hamiltonian for a period of time, delta t. Then we apply the first pulse, p. P is a pi pulse, so it takes sigma z to minus sigma z. Then we have another interval of evolution under the natural Hamiltonian of the same duration, delta t. And then, if you like, let's complete the cycle with another identical pi pulse. And let's see what we get out of this evolution. So the free evolution is, well, this is the exponential of the total Hamiltonian. That's easy. And then the second part, you see, there is a sandwich here. There is this p, and then the exponential of the Hamiltonian, and then p. P is a unitary operator. And I teach quantum mechanics, and some of my students here remember, bring them upstairs, because you can. You can bring them and have them sandwich directly the Hamiltonian, the exponential here. So these p's will act on the sigma z's here. They do nothing on the bath, because the bath is a different subsystem, so they have an identity action there. And they act on this sigma z here. So the net effect of this sandwich, it's almost lunchtime, so we have sandwiches, is the fact that we can think of them as they are putting a minus sign here. They are also putting a minus sign here. They do nothing on the bath. Okay? If you remember in the slides of the spin echo, I had the race track picture, and that had to do with time reversal, or motion reversal, in fact. We can think similarly here, because suppose now I have these two Hamiltonian. One is the original Hamiltonian, the other is the one that has been modified by the coherent action of the two pulses. If I only could put them together, add them together, I would get a total Hamiltonian. Can I? Can I do it exactly? Not really, because they don't commute with one another. But the amount or the extent of the non-commutation is determined in some sense by the time scale, delta t, which I have chosen, and that's the control time scales that I have. What I'm trying to say is that if I could disregard the fact that these two Hamiltonian, and the two Hamiltonian I'm talking about are HS plus H bath plus system bath, I switch, as you've noticed, environment and bath, they are totally synonymous. So I'm sorry, I should have said that before, but I hope that's clear. So that's the natural one. The effective one that we get with the pulses has the same sign here, but it has the minuses. So if I could disregard the commutation issue, I could happily sum this Hamiltonian to that one, I would get zero. I would get zero, which means I would get no evolution, right? And that's exactly what would freeze the evolution of the qubit, and therefore no coherence. Can I do that? Well, as I said, the extent to which I can do that depends on the time scale delta t. Why? Because, and this is the difference with respect, or one of the differences with respect to the plane spin echo, we have a bath of harmonic oscillator here. During the time delta t, they are not sitting there still. They evolve according to their own Hamiltonian. This one here. However, if we make the delta t sufficiently small, the evolution of the bath will also not be that much, which means that during the two segments of evolution, so between the first and the second pulse, the bath will be essentially frozen or approximately frozen in time, and if so, we can still have the picture of having an effective time reversal in place. So that's the intuition, and in fact, you can make this intuition mathematically precise in this model because you can compute under the assumption that the pulses are, as I was saying before, delta pulses, which are ideal. You can actually compute the effect of applying a train of pulses, and I have called TC a pair of pulses because after two, everything repeats. So that gives us a natural time unit for the problem. We have a different modified decoherence function with respect to the one that we had in the absence of pulses. But the nice thing is that we can do the calculation, and so we know everything that we can possibly ask about this system. And we can think of the action of the pulses in terms of, that's how they enter. This has an expression which is not complicated at all. It's just a tangent function. But you can view this, and the way we view this nowadays is more and more in terms of filter functions, as if the action of the controller is that of introducing a filter in frequency space so that it modifies the spectral density of the environment in a way that makes it more favorable. Remember, the controller is supposed to make things more favorable for you. And the way that it does, in this case, happens in the limit where the interval between successive control operation becomes so small that the ev- evolution becomes effectively frozen in time. So this is an exact result that can be proved in a limit. The limit is where, imagine you fix a given time evolution and you slice it up in many, 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 many elementary control cycles, each consisting of two pulses. Now, if the evolution time is finite, and if you want to send the separation between pulses to zero, clearly you have to also allow the number of these pulses to go to infinity. And this is why you see basically a double limit taking place here. But what is happening physically is like as long as the separation between the pulses, and this TC, remember, is nothing but twice as long, because I'm counting two for reason that will become clear in a second. As long as this separation is small enough that over that time scales, the bath degree of freedom don't have time to evolve, so they stay approximately frozen, which also means that over that time scale, the interaction between the system and the bath is essentially still a Hamiltonian interaction, is coherent. The bath has had no time to have whatever correlation got established between the system and its degrees of freedom. It didn't have time to get dispersed through the many degrees of freedom of the bath. Well, as long as that is the case, as long as the control period is short relatively to the correlation time scales, which is the fastest time over which the bath can move, can respond, then you can effectively have the coherent suppression. So that's the simplest example over which you can really touch by hand what's going on in these techniques. And I would like to stress, again, what these ideas of coherent averagings mean by and large is a regime of decoherence where the decoherence is truly non-Markovian. If the reservoir, if the bath degree of freedom, they instantaneously lose correlation or they decorrelate themselves in no time, then there is no way that a control action can be faster than a no time timescale. So in order for this idea of coherent averaging or spin flipping, or it will become much more complicated in a second, to be effective, what we need to have is a separation of timescales between the timescales for the bath evolution and the control timescales. The control timescales must be fast with respect to the bath. Usually we think of the bath as being fast, but here is exactly the regime in which, instead, we need to be faster than the bath in order to undo, to the extent that it is possible, the effect of the environment itself. So yes, I'll take the question. Let me just put up, there is another couple of comments that I wanted to have in this slide. For those of you who might be familiar with Zeno and anti-Zeno physics, there is an analogy in between continuously kicking the system with pulses, as well as continuously interrogating the system in terms of projective measurement. There is an analogy mathematically, it has been worked out, and I can tell you where. But let me stress again that the whole foundation for the machinery that I will now briefly develop for you on DQC rests on the fact that we have to have non-Markovian quantum noise in place. So let me just again remind you, dynamical quantum error correction can be thought in general now as a form of non-dissipative quantum error correction, in contrast to the usual one, because the usual one requires either measurements or, at the very least, the ability to reset the syndrome, so to refresh them in such a way that the code can take another error. So in contrast to that, I will only use, and this is open loop, we are engineering Hamiltonians of open system, so that should start making sense. And we are only going to use, at all times, unitary controls. Sometimes we are going to even be more restrictive and give ourselves a fixed repertoire, a fixed choice of unitary gates that we can apply. In other cases, especially when we do numerical approaches, we are just going to allow Hamiltonian controls, but still unitary. There is a lot that has happened. It would be impossible, it would take me several hours to go through everything. So in the rest of the time that we have, I'll try to tell you a little bit more on decoupling, on how to generalize with respect to the simplest example that we just revisited, and also something that has happened more recently and is attracting more attention now and is very interesting is how to use the ideas, the principle for coherent averaging, so removing interaction by, if you like, the way, for instance, that David Corey likes to put this is strongly modulating the natural internal dynamics of the system. We can extend that. When we are talking about decoherent suppression, we are essentially looking for ways to have a more robust quantum memory, right? Because we want the qubit to be stored for a longer time than it would be if left alone. But we can be more ambitious, and we can ask, and this is the second part, we can be more ambitious and try to do the same. As long as we have no Markovian decoherence, can we hope to remove that kind of decoherence or maybe reduce it significantly while at the same time steering the dynamics of the system in such a way that we perform a non-trivial quantum gates? So I'm just saying this because I don't know how much we will be able to cover. We can talk about that in the afternoon, but that's the broad picture. All right, memory first. And in particular, as you probably can guess, it is easiest to first deal with these ideal instantaneous pulses, which are the same kind that I have been using in the example, but ask, what if the system is not a single qubit? What if the decoherence mechanism is just more general? Can I still, in principle, come up with protocols that do the job for me? So here is the general control theoretic view of a decoupling problem. We said that we can go through this quickly. We have an open quantum system, environment, coupling between the two subsystems. So we are working on a joint Hilbert space. We can think that this is a 2 to the n dimensional state space. If we have, for instance, n qubits in general, that could be a register. We are interested in the reduced dynamics of the system alone. And, of course, the closed system limit we recover when these guys are not there. Okay, without loss of generality, because now I want to think generally, I can represent any system-environment interaction, at least on a bounded, my system is going to be finite dimensional, so I have no problem with that. It can be represented in terms of sum of tensor product of operators. These S's act on the system, these B's act on the bath, and I am going to call them error generators because it is only to the extent that these S's are there that I'm going to have all the bad decoherence and dissipation happen. Now, remember that I said that I don't want to make too many assumptions on the environment, so everything that I will do next, I will do with minimal assumptions on the system Hamiltonian and the bath, except that they are here in whatever form. So I'm not expecting to know them, even though if I know them, maybe I can take advantage of this. Okay, very important point in what I am saying, the environment is not going to be cooperative. What I call environment here is something that I cannot control at all. So the controller that I am introducing is only and always going to act non-trivially on the system, which is why, even though I will blur this distinction very soon, so I will drop the identity, you should always keep in mind that the control here has an identity on the bath subsystem. So that's a very useful object. This is the control propagator. It's just the time exponential of the control Hamiltonian. And also another very useful thing we do is typically we go look at the problem in a suitable interaction picture that is one that follows the control that we apply. Borrowing from NMR, this is the toggling frame picture. And what it means is that if we have the propagator for the system plus environment together in the Schrödinger picture, we can always view the, you are all familiar with interaction picture, this is just a different interaction picture with respect to the time-dependent Hamiltonian, that is the control Hamiltonian. And so we can always view the physical evolution in terms of, well, this is the propagator in the interaction picture, the toggling frame, and the control propagator. And the very nice thing is, keep that in mind, because even though my total Hamiltonian, remember the spin boson, we had a spin and a set of harmonic oscillator, this was a time-independent system. The Hamiltonian was constant in time. But if we look at that in the toggling frame representation, this Hamiltonian becomes sandwiched, again, by the control propagator, and so it's modulated in a way that we decide. So the task is going to be to come up with good ways to modulate these dynamics in such a way that nice things happen. All right, so nice things happen is what is our objective? As far as decoupling is concerned, well, what we want to suppress is the coupling to the environment. And if we are, if our objective is to have quantum memory, actually we also want to suppress any evolution that the system might have on its own, which is why I am putting under error Hamiltonians the generators, the, let me see, did I call them? I think E alpha, the, yeah, they were called S, I'll fix, they were called S and then switched to E, but okay. Anyway, so this should be that. We want to remove this coupling operator, and also, if we just want the system to do nothing, to do memory, this is also something that we want to remove effectively. The basic idea that you should think about, and this is the same idea that if time permit we will come back in order to get dynamically corrected gates, you can view the problem in the following form. We have a unitary propagator for the controlled system. The controlled system is system in the presence of the bath. If I don't trace over the bath, I have a unitary evolution. Right? So I can think in terms of unitary propagators as long as I don't trace. We can always think of the propagator for the system and the bath together as being the product of the control propagator, which presumably is achieving what I want the system to achieve, in particular identity, if I want to do a no operation, times something else. Something else is something that it's an operator that we call error action operator. The way to see this, remember that we moved into the toggling frame picture. We made a change of frame. We can always view the evolution as the product of the control propagator times, what is this? This is the toggling frame propagator. If we could, suppose we could cook up the control propagator, that's our job. Now we are going to synthesize the control. So if we want to, if we are able to construct a control propagator such that this whole thing becomes the identity on the system, tensor, something, anything on the bath, what would happen to the reduced dynamics of the system in that case? We are good, because after we trace over the bath, as long as we have a tensor product, and only if we have a tensor product, the two subsystems are going to be decoupled, and therefore we are not going to see the bath there. So that's the idea of viewing. That's also, as I said, NMR people, they call this a time suspension. And we can think of the decoupling problem as wanting to construct a control modulation such that we are, if you like, causing this equality to happen as best as possible. We are not going to be able to achieve that exactly, and how well we are going to achieve this, we are going to need a quantitative measure to quantify. This is where we can pick, for instance, how large the norm. This is an operator, right? So we need to invoke some kind of norm to quantify how big that norm is. And the norm of this operator, and there is a technical subnet, is because we can remove anything that deals with the bath only, but basically how big that operator is going to determine how distant the ideal, the actual state of the system will be with respect to the ideal one that we would like it to be. All right, so you can think of decoupling as ideally you would like to make this whole thing go away, so you would like to make this operator to be zero, because exponential of zero is identity. In practice, what we are trying to achieve is to make it as small as possible in some suitable sense. Is that clear? All right. Because then the technology comes, and we are going to, I mean, there are various ways to do that. The simplest possibility is to assume that this control propagator, remember, that's what we want to synthesize. The simplest possibility is like this is a cyclic controller which acts cyclic in time. There is a period associated to that, just like we had before. And the advantage of doing this is because we can borrow from the formalism of average Hamiltonian theory, which allows us, in that case, to represent the evolution of our system plus environment in terms of a time-independent average Hamiltonian theory, which we can compute by means of time-dependent perturbation theory, although it's not maybe the one that you are most familiar with, which is the Dyson series. This is a slightly different variant, which is called the Magnus expansion. The advantage being that it's an expansion such that if you truncate that at any order, it's guaranteed to give a unitary evolution, which the Dyson series doesn't. Think about it if you have not thought about that in practice. So this is a series. It's an infinite series. The lowest order terms are particularly easy. In particular, the lowest order or zeroth order term is nothing but the time average of the toggling frame Hamiltonian. Remember that we said that it becomes time dependent? Now you can look at the time average. That's it. And the second, the lowest order correction, takes into account of the non-commutativity of Hamiltonians in the toggling frame at different times. It's an infinite series, so the extent to which this description is going to be useful in practice is determined by the possibility of being able to truncate it at a sufficiently low order. The criterion that enables us to truncate it is to notice that, keep in mind the example that we went through for the single qubit in the presence of the spin of the boson bath, and we were flipping rapidly the spin. If we make the control time scale, this DC, sufficiently small, right? In the same sense that we were thinking before, having a fixed time, but making that time consist of many, many, many cycles in a limit. In that case, the series, the higher order of this series, which are all proportional to powers of this, they become smaller and smaller in a way that can be quantified. So bear with me for now. If I say that there exists a limit in which we can only worry about the lowest order term, And that's the one term that we have to construct in such a way that the system and the bath decouple. How to do that? This is where symmetry considerations come to the rescue. And what we can do is to try to, we have a temporal average in order to construct that lowest order Hamiltonian. A nice way or a nice procedure to follow is to map that temporal average into an average over a discrete group of operation, because that gives us automatically symmetry properties of the Hamiltonians we're going to construct. Technically speaking, what we imagine is that, forget a little bit about the sublattice, the idea here is like the unitary operations that we can apply on the system, they are taken out of a discrete group of unitary operations, and that group has a finite number of elements, and the recipe that we can use to construct what we call periodic decoupling is very simple, because remember that what we are after is the control propagator, right? Because that's the one that modulates the Hamiltonian. Well, how about taking a protocol which actually cycles the control propagator sequentially over all the unitary operators that belong to this discrete group? So we are going to have a cycle that consists of how many slots as the number of elements in the group are, and we are going to choose during this time interval the control propagator equal to the first element in the group, during this the second, and so on and so forth. What does it mean in terms of control Hamiltonian? This is the control propagator. The control propagator is the exponential of the Hamiltonian. So it means that if I want to change, for instance, typically this first element is the identity. If I want to change this propagator from a value to the next one, I will have to apply an instantaneous pulse here that does the job. So this recipe here, and I will give you an example in a second, is one where we are changing the propagator from piecewise constant values by applying arbitrarily strong pulses according to the group. So hold on, the example will come. The advantages in doing this, and the reason why the group structure is so convenient, is because the lowest order Hamiltonian that one gets out of this procedure is a sum of sandwiches. So this is the original Hamiltonian. It's sandwiched by all the group elements. And I don't know if I have any group theorists in here, but this is a symmetrizing projection operators that acts on H0. What it does, it takes any operator here, operator on the system, it projects it into some other operator that has the properties that commute with all the group elements that we have. So the physical intuition behind this is like, remember that we have a system bath Hamiltonian. So these operations, they act only on the system. I cannot do anything on the environment. So the environment Hamiltonian stays there, is there, and that's it. But the system Hamiltonian gets modified, it gets refocused, maybe, and the error operators get modified. So if I make sure that I choose the group such that I get a zero here and a zero here, that's all I have to do. This is one way to achieve error suppression and to filter out what I don't want to have. Examples are very much due at this point. First example, single cube. This example we have already done, but let's revisit that in this language. Single qubit, and this is a purely defacing interaction. What we can think about it is the spin flip, right? In the group language, it means that I can only do one control operation. Is the flipping, is the sigma z. To make it a group, I need the identity. So that's all we need. And the recipe means that each control cycle is two slots. In one case, I have the propagator being the identity. In the other, it's sigma x. How do I change the propagator from identity to sigma x? I apply a pi pulse in the x direction. There we go. This is exactly the same control protocol that we have used for the spin boson model. Why does it work? This group averaging, here it is, 1/2 identity, identity, and this is the flipping that we were having before. There is a neat trick that NMR experimentalists have discovered long ago. This is the sequence, it's pi pulse, pi pulse. If you just rearrange the two pulses in a different way, in such a way that you pick up a mirror symmetry, this is the same length, or at least it meant to be the same total length, okay? But imagine that you rearrange the two pulses in time so that overall there is a mirror symmetry with respect to the middle point. Then it is possible to show that all the odd terms in that Magnus series that I've mentioned, they automatically vanish by symmetry. So this buys us something very important, because we are improving the averaging that we are going to get for our decoherence suppression, because this sequence removes decoupling between the system and the environment to the first non-trivial order. But then still we have the higher order corrections, not that they go away. If we invoke symmetry in the sequences automatically, and this is well known, this was due to Karpusel in the NMR literature, we can make the size of the leftover terms even smaller, so that gives us better averaging. Let me move on another example. What if we are not so lucky that we have dephasing, like a phase damping? We have depolarization. We have arbitrary single qubit errors. Well, in that case, what we have to do is to change our group. And what we have to do in particular, this is a group that you have encountered already. I'm going to use it with a different spin. This is the Pauli group with the full choice of density matrices. Here is the control protocol. What does it mean? Identity X, Y, and Z. That's the recipe. Again, in order to change the control protocol from identity to sigma X, this I can do with a pi X, pi pulse. Now, to change it from sigma X to sigma Y, it's still a pi pulse, but I have to use another axis. I need to make it with a Z, and so on and so forth. So this is, and why does it work? Well, again, suppose that you follow and you compute the lowest order Hamiltonian. Now I have done it for X explicitly. This is it. You see, you get two pluses and two minuses. But this now works not only for X, like it worked here for Z. If you plug in Y and Z, it works just as fine. So you get zero, and the reason why you get zero is because actually this acts irreducibly on the state space of the qubit, for those of you who know what I'm talking about in representation theory terms. And this means that the only thing that can be left commuting with the action of all of this are just identity operators, but these operators are traceless, so this means that they get averaged to zero, no matter what. All right, I would like to go quickly on this, but I would like to stress that these ideas, they are viable not just for one qubit, they can be extended to as many qubits as you want. In particular, the most practically relevant scenarios is where we have a register which is undergoing arbitrary single qubit errors. No Markovian, but single qubit here. In that case, it is actually quite nice and easy to still come up with a group that does the averaging for us. Actually, the group is the same. It's the same Pauli group that I was using for one qubit, except now the representation changes, because all I am doing here is to replace these pi pulses with collective pi pulses that simultaneously flip all the spins in the system. And we can show that if that is the case, any single qubit error generator vanishes to zero to the first order. So that's the starting point, the entry point into decoupling. I have made it sound like it's a nice thing, but there are lots of problems that are looming on the horizon. That is, well, let's forget about the multi-qubit systems. There are ways to deal with making the design of decoupling more efficient, but what about, there are two main objections I think that you could move against this. Number one, I have showed you how to decouple system and bath to the first order, just removing the dominant coupling, but then there are these correction terms. Well, it's a good starting point, but these correction terms, they are there, and if the evolution time is long, they add up. So that's kind of bad. So a lot of effort is required in order to design what we call high-level decoupling, high-order decoupling, which can not only decouple the system to the lowest order, but they can also have higher order in the Magnus series vanish as well. The other big objection, which already was coming up before, is, I have talked about delta pulses, meaning that the controls, they are all singular, they are all bang bang, the pulses take no time. No experimentalist is so lucky that the pulses take zero time and they are perfect. So what about taking into account the fact that unavoidably pulses are fat, they have finite widths, and unavoidably they are not perfect, they come with, for instance, systematic errors. So these are areas where there's a lot has happened, and it's really a lot, because decoupling has become a zoo. There has been very many schemes that have been constructed, and even I've tried to collect here pulse decoupling. I should say that there is also continuous modulations that we can and we have explored, but within pulse decouplings, there are various kinds of ways to generate sequences. Some of them, like the one I showed you so far, they are generated analytically. There is an analytic recipe to come up with them. There are ways to do so, not using groups, but using other structures to make them work. I will highlight, just mention the name of two types of sequences which are called concatenated dynamical decoupling and optimal dynamical decoupling, in the sense that it uses the minimum number of pulses as possible. And then I would like to tell you, even though no detail at all, that there is a very well, a well-established way to take into account of width of finite durations of pulses. And this is just about memory, so forget about doing gates. So, all right, just at the level of highlights, concatenated dynamical decoupling is what I also like to call Russian doll dynamical decoupling, because you take a decoupling sequence and recursively nest it into one another. For instance, for a single qubit, I have just described a protocol where we had free evolution, pi pulse in X, free evolution, pi pulse in Z, free evolution, and so on and so forth. Suppose that you recursively take the same control operation, X, Z, X, Z, X, Z, X, Z, but rather than using free evolution, at the next layer, you use the sequence that you had come up with. So in this case, for instance, at level 2, this gives you a more complicated sequence, and it is possible to see that in spite of the sequences becoming more complex and longer, the benefit of this is that it is possible to achieve cancellation of the higher order terms in the sequence. How many orders? That depends on how many pulses you're willing to put in. Another way to achieve cancellations for high order terms in the series was discovered relatively recently by Urich. And the idea here is to, it's a different principle, it's like taking advantage of the fact that over a given duration that we might want to achieve memory, we can place the timings maybe optimally. So let's see if it is possible to treat the pulse times as control variables and figure out where the pulses have to be applied in order for the Magnus series to have n vanishing terms. This sounds complicated, but it's possible to do. And in the case of a single qubit, there is an analytical solution, quite remarkably. And you have this transcendental equation that tells you where you have to pulse the spins. This is nice because you can still cancel to nth order, and it uses less pulses than concatenation is. So just advertising for the fact that there is a way for overcoming the fact that we don't have to do all of this with instantaneous pulses. It is possible at the expenses of being a little bit more sophisticated in the way that we design our control field to achieve the same sort of group averaging and averaging of interaction between the system and the bath, at least to the lowest order, but with pulses which have a finite duration. As you see here, I had a slide which is pretty mathematical. It takes us back to not groups, but graphs, because, and actually to be precise, both. Because the main tool that we use to synthesize a control field that does it, in this case, is to go back to something that Euler discovered, which is Eulerian cycles on some graphs which have some regular properties that makes them to be Cayley graphs. So kind of like a visual representation of the multiplication table of a group. This would be inappropriate for me to go into detail here because I would have no opportunity to be clear at all, but it's not complicated. We can use the recipe. We can use it to come up with different control protocols which are called Eulerian decoupling protocols, which you can view as just a way, different ways to apply pulses according to a rule. And these pulses now, they have a duration which is finite, and so they have more opportunities to be realistic in some sense. So if we use Euler design, we also have an added bonus that comes in, and that is the fact that Euler control has some built-in robustness against some sort of systematic errors, in the sense that as long as we implement a given Hamiltonian, and every time we use that Hamiltonian, the kind of error, systematic error, that that Hamiltonian has is the same every time we use it, we basically are not sensitive to that error to the first order. Anyway. Maybe I can just say that, again, that would be the generalization once again of having a single qubit which undergoes dephasing. This, I think, we can get the intuition even without having done Eulerian decoupling. So by now we know very well what the spin echo is and what the previous decoupling bang, bang was doing. It's like pulse, pulse. But imagine that you do so like continuously in time, so you do sort of a continuous spin echo. So you apply a Hamiltonian, that would be the averaging operation, such that this is an averaging that is a little bit more complicated than it was before, but you see there is an integral over the two slots, delta t and delta t, and it still gives you zero due to anti-commutation properties. There are ways to generalize this which don't involve spiky pulses. That's all I want you to take away from that. More example, and that will be the point for me. Minus 2 minutes. To say that the reason why I put Euler decoupling there is because it would be also the starting point, maybe what's the objective here is. This you had already seen. This is exactly the same control theoretic picture that I had before. But I said, well, we can be more ambitious. We can hope for designing a controller which not only averages out to the extent possible the effect of the error generators, but is able to affect, say, a rotation, a non-trivial rotation on the system. This we call a dynamically corrected gate. And there are analogies. I don't know if you are a little bit familiar with composite pulses in NMR or strongly modulating pulses. Maybe those of you from Waterloo, while David Corey was among the people who has been used them a lot for high precision control in NMR. And it still uses the same coherent averaging ideas. So, which means, now I really don't have the time, but I would be very happy to talk about this in private discussion. What we are going to, what the hope is here is like putting together a sequence of control modulations. Each of them will affect what we call a primitive gate. This is something that the experimentalist can do in the lab, given the control knobs that are available. And the challenge here is to cascade many of these available gates, which obviously come with errors. There is decoherence that is going on because they take a finite amount of time. Do we all agree that if I take no time in performing a gate, there is no error during that gate? Decoherence has no time. So the only decoherence, if I have instantaneous gates, is in between the gates. But the story is very different if the gate takes time, because decoherence happens. So the challenge here is to take different segments, each of which has decoherence in between, and somehow, sounds like black magic, but really it's not, to package them together in such a way that the total decoherence error that happens is less than what happens in a single segment. So in practice, it is possible. For instance, if the decoherence is proportional to how long each of these segments takes, which is very natural, well, we want to devise control so that rather than having a decoherence error that scales directly with the length, it scales quadratically with the length of each segment. And if we can do it quadratically, then maybe we can concatenate, do it even to higher order. That's the idea of dynamically corrected gates. And at this point, you can see what I had for you. You can get them. I will leave all the slides. And of course, I will stay around for all kinds of questions you want to have. Let me say that Chris Monroe has been describing his system. I would like to advertise the fact that some of the beautiful recent experiments that they have done for composite kind of pulses in their lab for making them more robust. This was a Molnar-Sorensen gate, more robust against some kind of laser fluctuations, can be exactly interpreted within this framework. And I have references for you, but I'll leave everything here. Thank you for your attention. And take questions.